there are two kinds of AC to AC converter normally we use. One is AC voltage controller, which we started on the other day. The other one is cycloconverter. So we'll start off first with AC to AC conversion, where frequency is the same, but magnitude, that is output magnitude, changes. So this is very similar to using a variac. If I use a variac auto transformer, if you may recall, when we did machines course, we essentially had a variac somewhat like this. We would apply 230 volts single phase, 50 hertz here. And if we actually move this jockey point, correspondingly we are going to get different values of magnitudes at the output. So this magnitude depends upon how many turns are here. How many turns are here, that is going to decide how much is the magnitude. But the frequency is the same. Input was also 50 hertz and output was also 50 hertz. There is no difference as far as the frequency is concerned. Almost similar is the case with an AC voltage controller. If I am going to have a back-to-back connected thyristor configuration or ACR configuration, somewhat like this, and I'm going to connect the load here, and this is my input voltage. So this is Vs, and this is going to be V0, and this is going to be I0. I should rather say small I0, because instantaneous current. If we want to plot the waveform of the current, then I should show this as instantaneous current. So we said there are two types of control. One is integral cycle control, where I'm going to have for n number of cycles, the two thyristors are going to be turned on at 0 degree and 180 degree respectively. And for the next m cycles, they are not going to be turned on at all. So if I just look at the RMS value over n plus m cycle, I will have n divided by n plus m, square root of that, as the RMS value. So integral cycle control essentially will look at something like this. So I may have multiple number of cycles like this, and I'm going to probably keep this on for, let us say, two cycles, and I don't turn it on for one cycle. Again, for the next two cycles, I'm going to keep it on, and for the next one cycle, I'm not going to keep it on at all. So I would say in this case, n equal to 2, m equal to 1. So I'm going to have n divided by n plus m square root multiplied by whatever is my V in, that is going to be V out. Right? Because I'm looking at the RMS magnitude basically. So if you actually look at it, individually they are still at 50 hertz, although it is looking as though I am trying to apply it for two cycles together and one cycle I'm not applying it, but that does not change the frequency of the output voltage. It is still at 50 hertz. So if I apply it to probably an induction motor, it will still visualize the voltage as 50 hertz. It's not going to visualize it at as any other frequency. But as I told you, this is not good for those systems which are going to have lower time constants. So if the inertia is very small for a drive, then you would see very clearly during this time it will rotate, and then suddenly it will come down to zero speed, and again it has to start afresh and so on. So this particular system is not good for systems with low time constants. Only if my time constant is high, like a thermal system, where it is going to take a while for the temperature to rise. Similarly, it will take some time for the temperature to come down. So in those cases, integral cycle control can work. Otherwise, it cannot. Yes. If I am looking at the alternating current, it is still having 20 milliseconds as the cycle time. If I just look at any one of the cycles as such, I'm going to have between the positive and negative half cycle, if I look at the entire period, it is still 20 milliseconds. If input is 50 hertz, I will still have output to be 50 hertz. Exactly. It may not come at some point, it may be completely absent at some point, but wherever it is present, it is still following the same frequency. I'm not changing the frequency. So that's why we call this as a constant frequency system, whether we look at the input or output. We are not changing the frequency. We will look at the cycloconverter where you would very clearly see the input frequency and the output frequency would be different. We'll look at that also, right? So right now, all I can say is because the positive half cycle and negative half cycle, if you look at it and for the entire cycle, the cycle time is still the same as the input, I would say that the frequency has not changed really, right? So this particular system is good only for those kind of configurations where I'm going to have a huge time response. Response time has to be large. So it is definitely not good for small single phase induction motors and such things. The next type of control what we were talking about the other day was phase control or phase angle control. So in phase control, we are still going to have a back-to-back connected thyristor pair or a triac. I wanted you guys to look at this on your own about triac. I hope you guys have done it. Please, if you have not done it, please take a look at what really triac is, how it is different from an SCR, how its construction changes, how its control changes. So here is going to be my source and this is the load. Right? Now I'm going to actually control it in such a way that this is my sinusoidal voltage and I am probably going to fire this at alpha here and I'm going to fire, so one is fired at this point and if I may call this as two, this is fired at pi plus alpha symmetrically. So positive half cycle and negative half cycle have to be, the firing has to be symmetric. So if I do this, I may have, if it is resistance load, what we talked about the other day, if it is a resistive load, I'm going to have essentially the current following the same wave shape, right? It will follow the same wave shape. Only thing is, it will be V by R. That's all, right? So I will have this particular device to be forward biased only when I'm going to have plus here and minus here. And that will happen only during positive half cycle. So I need to necessarily fire this device, number one, only during the positive half cycle. I cannot fire it during the negative half cycle. So if I do that, and if it is a resistive load, I am going to have a current somewhat like this. This is how the current is going to be. Right? And if I look at the voltage is going to be actually only this portion. So I will have the portion, whatever I have shown as shaded portion, that is going to be the output voltage. So this is going to repeat itself in the next cycle as well. So here also the frequency does not change. I hope you understand, because if I look at the positive half cycle, negative half cycle, although I have zero voltage interval or zero current interval, if I try to start from the beginning of one half cycle to the end of the other half cycle, it is still 20 milliseconds. So the frequency has not changed. Only thing is, the wave shape is not sinusoidal anymore. So that can have definitely repercussions on the functioning of many of the equipment which you are supplying with this kind of voltage. You guys might have noticed that when you have a fan rotating with full speed, you may not really hear some kind of noise, you know. Whereas when you reduce the speed, because you are applying a non-sinusoidal voltage, that actually creates a large number of harmonic currents to be injected into the motor. And I hope all of you guys remember the basic functioning of an induction motor. If you have actually 50 hertz supply applied to an induction motor, you are going to have a revolving magnetic field setup, which is corresponding to 120 F by P. Right? P is the how many number of poles you have. P is the number of poles, basically. So if it is a two-pole machine, the revolving magnetic field will be at 300 RPM, 3000 RPM, and so on and so forth. So if I have multiple harmonics, that is, I'm going to have, say, third harmonic, fifth harmonic, seventh harmonic, and so on. Even harmonics will be absent because there will be half-wave symmetry. If you try to actually get the average value will be zero. So also will be all the even harmonics. All the even harmonics will be absent as long as I have symmetrical firing. The positive half cycle and negative half cycle are exactly the replica of each other, right? So in that case, I'm going to have third harmonic, fifth harmonic, seventh harmonic, and so on and so forth being injected into the motor. So which means I will have one revolving magnetic field at omega s, another revolving magnetic field probably at 3 omega s, another one at 5 omega s. We will see that this will be generally in the opposite direction. I don't want to really extend upon this much, but again, I'm going to have one more revolving magnetic field at 7 omega s and so on and so forth. So I will have several revolving magnetic fields superposed on each other. So the rotor is heavily confused. It can be accelerated because of the fundamental revolving magnetic field, or it can be accelerated because of third, fifth, seventh, and so on and so forth. So whatever is the dominating one, that is going to contribute to the real speed of the induction motor. The dominating one normally happens to be the fundamental. However, rest of the torques are also interfering with the operation of the motor, which will work more like a braking torque rather than a motoring torque, because they are trying to rotate this at a different speed. So they are not going to aid the rotation at omega s or slightly less than omega s. They are going to rather create some kind of havoc in the complete dynamics of the system. And that is the reason why you hear that noise. There will be a lot of vibrations, because there will be motoring action because of the fundamental torque or fundamental revolving magnetic field. Along with that, there will be braking action simultaneously because of the higher harmonic revolving magnetic fields. So this is essentially going to create the noise that you hear in the motor drive normally. You might have seen also, if you have a home inverter which is not giving you sinusoidal output, which is going to be some kind of square wave or quasi-square wave output, when you switch over from the regular sinusoidal grid supply to the inverter supply, you will hear again the same noise. The inverter essentially is not supplying sinusoidal voltage, it is supplying some kind of square wave voltage or some chopped square wave voltage, because of which you would normally hear, you know, a lot of noise in the motor. So you will know when it is switching over from the grid supply to the inverter supply, immediately you will know because of the noise that you hear in the motor drive, especially fan if it is running. So you would hear that. So this is one of the easier ways of controlling the voltage magnitude, no doubt. But this is definitely not the best way of controlling the voltage magnitude, because you're trying to chop off some portion of the sinusoid. You're applying only some portion of the sinusoid, which means you are not really pumping the motor with sinusoidal currents. You are actually pumping it with harmonic currents. That's the reason, right? So in this case, if I have to get what is the voltage, I have to say alpha to pi Vm square sine square omega t. d omega t, right? And 1 by pi, and I have to take the square root. This will be the RMS value of the voltage that I will be getting when I am having resistive load. We are talking about this in the case of resistive load. If I replace this by an RL load, right? Now what is going to happen is, I'll have to again write the equation Vm sin omega t. This is Vm, by the way, per phase peak. That is Vm, right? We are talking about single phase. So I'm talking about per phase peak. So Vm sin omega t is equal to Ri plus L di by dt for alpha to pi. If I am talking about R load, but if I am talking about RL load, the current might continue beyond pi, because there will be inductance stored energy, and that inductance stored energy is going to definitely make the current continue even beyond the positive half cycle, like what we saw in the case of a rectifier. There also we said that the two devices which were actually being forward biased because of the supply voltage during positive half cycle, they'll continue to conduct even after the end of the positive half cycle because of the inductance stored energy. So if I look at the voltage and current waveform corresponding to this, let us say this is my voltage waveform, right? And I am firing device number one at alpha, and I am firing device number two at pi plus alpha. So I'm going to have the current rise slowly. And at what point it reaches peak, it depends upon, again, L di by dt equal to Vm sin omega t minus Ri. If that becomes zero, then I'm going to have the di by dt reaching its maximum. I mean, di by dt becoming zero, which means current is reaching maximum. So maybe current reaches maximum here, and it is probably going to continue until here. Right? I have to definitely solve for the transient equation, and I will have one complementary function and particular integral, right? Transient solution and steady state solution. So the steady state solution will be Vm by Z multiplied by sine omega t minus phi. That is the way normally you are going to have the function, right? Phi is the power factor angle for the RL load, and Z is omega L whole square plus R square square root. Right? So that you know. And as far as the transient solution is concerned, we will have an exponential decay in term, where we might write that as some k into e power minus t by tau. What is tau? That is the time constant of the RL circuit. That's it. So if I write the solution for this, I have to write this as I of omega t equal to Vm divided by Z sine of omega t minus phi, where phi is the power factor angle of the load, plus some k multiplied by e power minus t by tau, where tau is L by R. Right? Now k can be solved for by substituting an initial condition. So initial condition in this case is I of alpha equal to 0. That is the initial condition. So you guys should be able to definitely solve for the entire equation. That's not a problem. But now, because the current continues until here, I will have this particular device, one, which is carrying current in the forward direction. Please note, two cannot carry the current in the forward direction. One has to carry the current in the forward direction. And if one is carrying the current in the forward direction, if I call this point as A and this point as B, A is always connected here and B is here, connected here. That is how it is going to be. Right? So whatever is my voltage across AB, which is the supply voltage, that is going to come up across the load as long as one is conducting. So I should have this entire voltage coming up until here. This is the way this voltage is going to come up until beta, wherever the current stops, you know, rather it reaches zero value. So it will reach zero value when the inductance stored energy ceases to exist. Until now, the inductance stored energy was making sure that the current continues. So it was taking care of whatever is the resistance loss and also the opposition provided by the power supply. It has essentially taken care of both of them. But after some time, because the energy is lost, di by dt has been now negative. So automatically it is going to come to zero. Now the same thing happens on the other side as well. I am going to have again the current rising, and probably it is going to go until here, which is pi plus beta. Nay, pi plus beta, because if I call this as beta, it should be pi plus beta. This is beta. So I have to just add pi. Right? So this is pi plus beta. So I am going to have the voltage here again coming up until this point. So I will have this entire voltage coming up here like this. From here it will start and it will go until here. This entire portion is going to come up as the load voltage. Right? So in this particular case, it is not very easy for me to calculate the RMS value until I solve for beta. So for solving for beta, you need to first of all get K value by substituting the initial condition, and after getting the initial condition, you will get a closed form expression for the current. Now you have to say this current will become zero again at beta. So I of beta equal to zero. Once you have got the I expression, you can say I of beta equal to zero, then solve for beta. And it is not going to be easy to solve for that in all probability, because you might have to use, so there will be some trigonometric expressions and there will be, you know, exponential expression together. So you might have to use some kind of transcendental equation solution method, iterative solution method, right? So it is not going to be easy to solve for that normally. Now, if I say that this is my alpha value and the current has continued until here, I reduce my alpha. Let us say my alpha is currently at 45 degrees. I just bring it down slightly. Now what is going to happen is, if I try to bring it down, this is my sinusoid. So I'm going to fire it right here, even earlier. So which means the current would definitely start increasing from earlier, agreed. So the energy stored in the inductance can also become more. I hope you understand, right? So what will happen is, I am trying to fire this other device at this point. I am trying to fire the other device at this point. So I may have the current actually just going and reaching beyond this particular alpha, pi plus alpha. If I have large amount of energy stored in the inductance, it can go beyond pi plus alpha, right? In which case, I am not going to have any control over the voltage. I hope you understand, because I am firing one here and I am firing two here, right? But as long as one is conducting, I'm going to get this entire voltage coming up. Whether I like it or not, this entire voltage will come up. So I will have the voltage coming up until this beta, if I may call that as beta. And beta is beyond alpha, right? Pi plus alpha. So I am going to have continuously the voltages coming up, and after this particular alpha, pi plus alpha, if I am not able to fire two, then completely I will not have any voltage at all. But as a rule, I told you that any of the thyristor converter circuits, be it rectifier, be it AC voltage controller, we will not give one pulse. We will give a train of pulses. And the number of pulses we give will be large in number, and generally it will be for 180 degrees if it is a single phase case, And if it is three-phase case, I'll give it for 120 degrees. I will never give one single pulse for a microsecond or something chod diya. No, we never do that. Because this is the case where I still have the current going in the forward direction. When the current is going in the forward direction, even if I try to fire device number two, that will not be possible for me to fire it. Because I am going to have, when this device is conducting, I will have a voltage drop like this. And that small voltage drop is good enough to reverse bias the other thyristor. So when one thyristor is conducting, whatever I do, the anti-parallel thyristor cannot be fired. And because of that, I cannot just give one pulse and stop. I need to give a train of pulses. It is very important for me to give a train of pulses. Otherwise, I'm not going to be able to fire the other thyristor. So I would actually give the pulse in such a way that if I am talking about alpha, alpha to pi plus alpha, I will give for 1. And from pi plus alpha to 2 pi plus alpha, I will give for 2. This is how normally I will give pulses. But it will not be a single square pulse because it will go through always a pulse transformer. So I will have high frequency anding and so on and so forth, whatever we talked about earlier. Pulse transformer will give you the isolation between the gate and the power circuit and the control circuit, right? So please note that now if I am applying completely a sinusoidal voltage, because there is no control at all, my current will also be definitely sinusoidal. If I am applying a sinusoidal voltage, why would the current not be sinusoidal? It has to be sinusoidal. So now I am not getting any control. Absolutely. And if I try to look at what is the phase shift between the voltage and current, you know, waveform, it will be exactly same as the power factor angle of the load. It cannot be any different from the power factor angle of the load. You try to fire it at alpha. I started as though the current is starting at alpha, but it is not true because here it is going beyond alpha, which means the same thing should have been true as far as the positive half cycle is also concerned. Transient, initially, yes, it might have started from alpha, but eventually it will settle down in such a way that the phase shift between the current and voltage becomes phi, which is the power factor angle, right? So when there is no control, then I'm going to have the power factor angle to be tan inverse of omega L by R. It's not going to be any different, right? When there is control, the current is discontinuous. When there is no control, I am going to have essentially continuous current, although it is alternating current. Alternating current, it will pass through zero just for moment. Momentarily, it will pass through zero, but I will have essentially continuous current. So in this case, I should say it is continuous sinusoidal current. So I will essentially have, if this is my voltage, I'm going to have the current exactly again sinusoidal with the power factor angle being phi or whatever. So this is going to be my power factor angle phi. So the bottom line is, if I try to fire my AC voltage controller below phi, an angle below phi, I lose control. I don't have control because the inductance will anyway push the current until phi. The current is going to be pushed until phi, whether I like it or not. So if the current is continuing until phi or pi plus phi, whatever, I am really not going to be able to say that one device will go off before I fire the other device. That is not going to happen. So we will get control. So control of the output voltage is possible only if alpha is greater than phi, where phi is the power factor angle. So this is one of the criteria that's very, very important for the control of any of the single phase equipment if I want to have a control over the voltage. Fortunately, probably for three phase, a single phase induction motor, although the inductance is somewhat larger, we will generally not control it below 45 degrees or 50 degrees of firing angle. So we will always have the range because the power factor angle will roughly be about 50, 60 degrees. So we will only have the control range from 50 degrees until 180 degrees in the single phase induction motor case. And we will not go until 180 because if we go until 180, the motor will not get any voltage. So we will not generally go until 180, but we try to limit the range of the firing control only from power factor angle phi until whatever is the maximum firing angle that could be fired. That is the way normally it is done. And invariably, the firing of rectifiers or AC voltage controllers will be synchronized with whatever is my incoming supply. So normally, the firing circuit will work in such a way that I first take the sinusoid from the supply itself by using a potential transformer, which will be like a step-down transformer. So from 230 volts, it will step it down to 3 volts or 2 volts, right? So that kind of a stepping down action we have to do. So this will be done with the step-down potential transformer. So it is essentially as good as having an open circuit on the secondary side. It is like no load test on a transformer. Similar condition will exist here. I will not connect any big load, right? And it will be rated for 1 volt ampere or even less. Very, very small volt ampere rating. So this sinusoid will be actually given to a comparator. Operational amplifier, what you did in ELL 100, right? The same kind of operational amplifier in open loop condition, when we use it as a comparator, to plus we may give this and the minus may be grounded. Right? If we do that, what we get here will be a square wave, because whenever the plus terminal is at a higher potential than ground, I'm going to get a positive saturation voltage, and whenever I'm going to have the positive terminal, that is the sinusoidal voltage, is less than ground, I will get a negative saturation voltage. So I can get a voltage here such that it will be somewhat like this. I'm going to have a square wave coming out. Right? Now this I can use probably with the help of a level shifter, or I can even have the plus VCC as 15 volts, minus VCC at 0. Because there are operational amplifiers which work like that. So I don't even have to go until negative. But if I have negative also, I can use after this an integrator. Again, an operational amplifier circuit. Right? So if I use an integrator, I will get the output to be something like this. Right? If I don't have any offset error, then this is how the integrator will work. Whenever I'm going to get a positive voltage constant, as I integrate, it will ramp up. And whenever I have a negative voltage, it will ramp down. This is how it is going to be. Right? Now, this can be compared again. So, integrator output is this. This can be again given to an op-amp comparator. Maybe I can make this as plus, and in the minus, I can give some constant DC voltage. So if I know that the peak of this is going to be, let us say, 10 volts, for example, right? So if I give this constant DC voltage to be 5 volts, then I'm going to have the comparator output actually giving me, whenever my integrator output is greater than 5 volts, I'm going to have a positive signal. Otherwise, I will have a negative signal. So I would have the intersection of these two voltages. If this is 5 volts, for example, this is going to give me a signal somewhat like this. So this voltage, the constant DC voltage, is generally specified as control voltage, because this is the one which is going to decide the firing angle. If I have 5 volts, I will have exactly somewhere in the middle. So that is going to be about 90 degrees. If I'm going to, because this whole thing is 180 degrees, and this is another 180 degrees. So if I choose 5 volts, I'll basically get a firing angle of 90 degrees. If I choose less than that, 2.5 volts, I'll get 45 degrees, and so on and so forth. So this particular voltage, what I am using as the control voltage, decides the firing angle. So in old, good old days, when we were using only analog electronic circuits to generate the firing signals for all these things, we used to do this, basically. All of us have done this to fire the thyristor circuits. Please note, the entire thing is now synchronized with the sinusoid. The complete thing is synchronized with sinusoid. So please note that the line commutated converters, be it rectifier, be it AC voltage controller, anything that works from an AC supply has to be synchronized with the AC supply so that the firing signals go at the appropriate instance. Otherwise, you will not be able to designate this is what is positive half cycle and this is what is negative half cycle. So all these have to be synchronized with the input sinusoidal wave. So this is basically the firing signal generation that is done for AC voltage controller, for example. Right? So what I'm trying to get at is, if I know the power factor angle, then I have to adjust the control voltage as per the power factor angle so that I get control over the voltage. Otherwise, I will not get control over the output voltage. That's what I'm trying to get at. You get my point? So the control voltage plays a very vital role in deciding the firing angle, and the firing angle will be decided based on whether I require control. If I require control, it has to be greater than the power factor angle phi. Okay? So much so for single phase AC voltage controller. Let me try to now go in for the three phase AC voltage controller. Previous? Yeah? Yes. So I might have to have exactly another 180 degree opposite waveform to generate for the other T2. So I have to have one for T1 and one for T2. I need to generate two different firing signals, definitely. But if it is a triac, we'll have to think whether we can combine these two, because it is a triac, we'll have only one gate terminal. His question was, this will generate firing signal only at alpha, then 2 pi plus alpha, and so on and so forth, 4 pi plus alpha, because of which it is generating the firing signal only for T1, not for T2. So if I want for T2, I might have to just invert this. This has to be completely 180 degree opposite, and then again I can use integrator and so on and so forth, so which will give me exactly the opposite of whatever I'm getting, or 180 degree shifted waveform for the other one. Right? So I can use one more comparator with plus here and minus here. That will do the job. Right? That's how it is. Okay? Now, let us now go over to the three-phase AC voltage controller. There are several configurations, and one of the toughest circuits to analyze I have seen is the three-phase AC voltage controller. So let me take only one single configuration, which is the star connected configuration. Let me not go into delta. I am going to take only a star connected configuration. What I mean is, I'm going to have the three phase supply voltages connected in star and the AC voltage control devices also connected in series directly with this. And the load also I'm going to take in star. Now I'm going to take the load also exactly connected in star. Let me again start with resistance load. Otherwise, you know, it could be more confusing. Let me start off first with resistive load. And let's say the numbering is essentially the same as what we did, 1, 4, 3, 6, and 5, 2. This is how they are numbered. So let me call this as VA, VB, and VC with respect to neutral. This is the neutral of the source, whereas this is the neutral of the load. The load also I'm showing as star connected. So that is neutral of the load. Now, let me take a firing angle of 60 degrees. Let's see how the waveforms go, because I'm just drawing right in front of you. Let's see how it goes. Okay? So I'm going to take 60 degree firing angle. This is A phase. And I told you that the firing angle in this case is always calculated with respect to phase voltages. So I'm going to have, this is the B phase. And this is going to be the C phase. Right? These are the three phase voltages. And if I am firing device number 1 at 60 degrees, that means I should have fired device number 1 here, because this is A phase, this is B phase, and this is C phase. So I am firing device number 1 exactly at this point for alpha equal to 60 degrees. Right? So obviously, I will have to fire device number 2 here, device number 3, device number 4, 5, and 6 should have been fired here. Okay? And 6, when it is fired, I should have B to be negative. Yes, B is negative. No problem. Right? Similarly, when I am firing 1, A should be positive. A is positive. That's not a problem. So before 1 is being fired, 5 and 6 should have conducted together. Right? But now when I am firing 1, let me start looking from this point. When I am firing 1, I am going to have actually 1 and 6 conducting together. So I am going to have the current flowing like this, and it is going to return like this. Right? Will 5 conduct at this point? I have to check. Because 5 can very well conduct if it is conducive. The situation is conducive. And 5 will conduct only if C phase voltage is positive. But C phase voltage is not positive when I am firing 1. Fortunately, if it is resistive load. That's why I didn't want to go into inductive load first. If it is resistive load, at this point, right, when I am looking at this point, I am not going to have clearly C is becoming negative from this point. So phi cannot be conducting. I will have only 1 and 6 conducting. And when 1 and 6 are conducting, what I am getting as the load voltage is A here and B here. Assuming that my devices are not having any voltage drop. I'm getting essentially VAB across the two portions of the load. The third portion is inactive. The third portion is not even conducting. Only two portions are conducting. So if I may call this as load A, so let us say this is RA or ZA, whatever, ZA, ZB, and ZC. Only ZA and ZB are active. ZC is not active. Am I right? So if I try to look at what is the load voltage, load per phase voltage. What do I mean by load per phase voltage? If I look at what is the voltage across this alone, or the voltage across this alone, that is the load per phase voltage. If I assume that it is balanced load, VAB is coming across ZA and ZB, and ZA and ZB are of equal magnitude. So I should have VAB by 2 across ZA, VAB by 2 again across ZB. Both of them have to be half of the total line-to-line voltage that is coming across each of the load. Now, I have to look for VAB. So if I have to draw VAB, this is VA. VAB should have been 30 degrees leading. So it must have become peak somewhere here, and then it should come down something like this. At 30 degrees, it should have come down to zero. That is VAB. What I have drawn in pink color, that is VAB. Now, I have to say from this point onwards, I'm going to have VAB, right? So I will have VAB coming up maybe like this. That is the peak, I suppose. Or close to peak, whatever. And I'm going to have this coming down like this. This is how it is going to be. That is VAB by 2. What I will get will be VAB by 2. If I am drawing, you know, so voltage across VZA, only voltage across ZA or impedance of A phase. That impedance across that, what is the voltage if I try to draw? This is the load per phase voltage. Per phase voltage of the load. So this will be VAB divided by 2. Is this clear? When I am having 6 and 1 are conducting, I have only AB voltage coming across ZA and ZB. So voltage across individually ZA and ZB individually will be VAB by 2. Only thing is, you have to understand that this point is positive with respect to neutral, whereas this point is negative with respect to neutral, because the current is flowing towards that. So that is at a lower potential, clearly. With respect to neutral, I will have one of them as positive, one of them as negative, because of the current direction. As simple as that. Now, when 2 takes over, will 6 go away? That I have to check again. When 2 takes over, right? Whether 6 will go away, because 6 corresponds to B phase. Fortunately, B is becoming positive. So B will go away. That is, 6 will go away when I am firing 2 automatically. So I will not have 6 conducting. From this point onwards, it will be 1, 2. And 1, 2 is VAC. So in all probability, I will have a similar waveform, because I will have again, this is VAC by 2. Because A phase and C phase will conduct now together. So if I try to draw the current for the next one, I should draw it as though the current is flowing like this through this. Now B phase is inactive for the next 60 degrees. Right? So I am going to have VAB by 2, then VAC by 2. After VAC by 2, I am firing 3. When I fire 3, whether 1 will go away? Yes, 1 has to go away. Because A phase is positive and it is beginning to become negative here. So obviously, when I fire 3, 1 is going away. So if 1 is going away, I will have only 2 and 3 conducting together from this point onwards. So I am actually going to have 60-60 degree interval. Here 6 and 1 will conduct. Here 1 and 2 will conduct. Here 2 and 3 will conduct. Provided it is a resistive load. I have not touched upon inductance. Now if 2 and 3 are conducting here, please note, I would rather have the current this way. The current will go like this and return like this. So this is for 2 and 3. And this is for 1 and 2. And this green is for 6 and 1. You get my point? So I'm going to have now 2 and 3 conducting. ZA is inactive. ZA is going to be inactive. So I would probably have this abruptly coming down and just keeping mum for some time. When 2 and 3 are conducting, ZA is inactive, completely inactive. So I will have literally zero voltage, no voltage at all across ZA. Now I will have a similar one on the other side when 4 is conducting. 3 and 4 conducting will be VBA. So opposite of VAB. I will have VBA by 2. Similarly, when 4 and 5 are conducting, it will be VCA by 2. So in all probability, it will be a replica of this, but in the opposite direction, something like this. Right? Please note, we have taken a specific case of firing angle and resistive load. We have taken 60 degrees. If we had taken slightly earlier, for example, 45 degrees, I would have fired 1 slightly earlier. When I fire 1 slightly earlier, C phase is still positive. Phi will not give up. Phi will say, I will also conduct because I am forward biased. Why not I conduct? As simple as that. You get my point? So whenever I am going to have the firing angle less than 60 for our load, I will have sometimes 3 devices conducting, sometimes 2 devices conducting. So AC voltage controller is a tough nut to crack. That's all I'm trying to tell you as the bottom line. Okay? It was my PhD topic. I was actually controlling an induction motor drive with AC voltage controller, 3-phase. So on the top of R and L, you will also have the back EMF. So it is as good as, you know, having more complications. But very, very, you know, intriguing and very complex, very great to really analyze and understand. If we really do it, you know, patiently. So if I try to look for a firing angle less than 60 degrees, for example, if I fire 1 here, 2 here, and so on and so forth. If I fire 1 here, please understand, phi will continue to conduct. Because phi will continue to conduct, I will have 5, 6, 1, all 3 of them conducting simultaneously. When I have 5, 6, 1, all 3 of them being connected to the load, it's as good as having a normal 3-phase supply. I hope you understand. It is not any different from having a 3-phase supply. When I have 5, 6, 1, 5 belongs to C phase, 6 belongs to B phase, 1 belongs to A phase. So when I have 5, 6, 1 conducting, it is as good as having a normal 3-phase supply connected to the 3-phase load. So only for that duration where 5, 6, 1 will conduct, if I try to look at what is A phase voltage, what is B phase voltage, and what is C phase voltage, it will be corresponding phase voltages itself. VAN, capital N I'm talking about. VBN for the other one. VCN for the third one. In fact, I have done simulations for different values of firing angles with resistance load and RL load. I have made the notes for AC voltage controller already, and I will upload it. I would request you earnestly to take a look at the waveforms thoroughly. Please take a look at the waveforms, because I've done it for R load, I've done it for RL load, for alpha equal to 45, alpha equal to 60, alpha equal to 75. I've done it for different firing angles. And I have already gotten the waveform from PSIM, and I have already put it up in the form of a notes. I've written some connotations also for each of them. So I would say that had it been an inductive load, with that, I'll conclude. I will not go on and on for three-phase AC voltage controller anymore. Had it been an inductive load, what was going to happen for the same case? That's what I want to check. So if this is omega t for the same 60-degree firing angle, so this is going to be my one of the phase sinusoid. This is going to be the next phase, and this is the third phase. Let me take the same 60-degree firing angle. So I'm going to fire one here, two, three, 4, 5, and 6. We said earlier that when I was firing 1, automatically 5 will go away because it was having resistive load and C was becoming negative. So obviously that has to go away. But now I am having inductive load. If I have inductive load, the inductance stored energy is going to pitch in, definitely. That is not going to allow 5 to go out, because the current is still flowing through the inductance. Abruptly, the current cannot come down to 0. So even at this point where I am firing 1, I will have 5 continuing to conduct despite the fact that I'm going to have C phase voltage coming into negative half cycle. So at this point itself, I will have actually 5, 6 and 1, all three of them continuing to conduct. All of them will continue to conduct together. And how long 5 will continue? That depends upon essentially what is the kind of inductance value I am having in comparison to the resistance. If the inductance value is really dominating, I will have a good amount of energy, because of which I would have had probably 5 continuing even until here or whatever. But if the inductance stored energy is not too much, it will go closer and closer to the resistive load. Okay? So if I assume that maybe until this point, 5 is continuing to conduct, then I should definitely assume the same way until this point, 6 will continue to conduct, until this point, 1 will continue to conduct, until this point, you know, 3 will continue, 2 will continue to conduct, and so on and so forth. So I have shown different points where I may have continuation of conduction of the previous device which should have gone off, but it has not gone off because of inductance. So now, until this point, because 5, 6, 1 are conducting, if I try to look at what is the voltage across ZA, right? Yeah, just 2 minutes. We are going to have, of course, quiz today. That's the reason I called. So, please listen to this and then we will have 5, 6, 1, when all three of them are conducting together, right? Arivai, please listen. When 5, 6 and 1 are continuing to conduct, we are going to have whatever is VA. The same voltage will come up. So during this portion, I had to show VA as such. I just reproduce what is VA. Exactly. After that, if I am going to have 6 and 1 conducting, only 6 and 1 conducting, then obviously I am going to have, when 6 and 1 are conducting, I will have exactly similar to this, VAB by 2. Right? We will have VAB by 2. So I have to check really how much the magnitude is and what happens. So this is VAN, whereas this will be VAB by 2. You get my point? So like this, the phase voltage and the half of line voltage will alternate continuously. You will see that this happens whenever I have RL load and with not a very high firing angle. The firing angle is 60, 40, 45. Then I'm going to have something like this continuously. Right? Now I would request you guys to spread yourselves up, please. So that we can have the quiz. Quick. Otherwise, you will get less time. I think piche kai sare khali hai. I don't want you guys to cluster here. Please, no. Siddhesh, Shiv, piche chale jao. Better hai. One second.